In 1972, jazz rock guitarist Larry Coryell released what I believe to be his 7th studio album as a headliner. Yes, Offering. And from it, the title track. Okay, a bit of a dark beginning to what is ultimately going to be a rip-roaring track. So far, we are hearing the bass of Mervin, Bronson, and the Moron. Okay, I believe he's interacting right there with Steve Marcus. Hear those really tight staccato notes of Coryell. Just that fiery sizzle of his tone. Yeah, Harry Wilkinson is the drummer. And he wrote the track. Just throw those scales around and just the tone and the clarity and the bite of it all. Really loopy. Just. Going in those like those bendy notes and then going into more like rapid runs. Oh, here Coryell and Steve Marcus just collide. Yes, Steve Marcus, who also put out some good like jazz rock solo albums around this time, and later reemerging. The guy who wrote the original sax riff that was later appropriated on Baker Street. Oh, here, yeah, Steve Marcus just like throwing that soprano sax around, like up for those high, sustained, fluid. Okay, I'm hearing something else emerging. I think Mike Mandel is about to come through. Oh, the way that Marcus just kind of like swelled up right there got more kind of like trebly and fuller and just as Coryell started throwing in those like sharp those chordal shards like dun dun like.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, holding those notes, yeah, and then dropping them and just going more in that drizzle. Oh, those really like high bends and slides. Yeah, kind of like something almost like Sonny Sharrock would have done, or that could have shown up later, like on the New York scene. Avant-garde Larry Coryell gets on this. I mean, because that's not like that's not one of the main things that he's been associated with throughout his career, particularly, well, at least not after like the 11 times. There's so much sizzle in the guitar tone. Yeah, this is definitely one of those albums that all rock guitarists of the period should have been listening to for, like solutions on terms of, like, tone, speed, runs, you know. The guitar tone and such, it gives me the feel of like that Ramatam record. Oh, I like those descending like chords he was like throwing around, spinning around there. Yeah, I'm getting the feel kind of like one of those psychedelic hard rock bands with like really exceptional guitar work from the period. Now they're getting just kind of like dueling one another, trying to find a way, I guess, forward. And I'm hearing those rolls that are being thrown in by the drummer. Oh, hear those harmonic notes? Yeah, those pull-offs. Yeah, and don't forget, that was written by the drummer. Yeah, and at times toward the end, toward the climax of the track, he was like spending a few bars maybe like pulverizing the whole structure and then throwing in some rolls at the end of each like figure of eight or something. And then, Coryell just kind of mangling it as it concluded. Yeah, that was Offering by Larry Coryell from the 1972 Vanguard release of the same name. Let's hear another track from the album, Scotland Eye. Okay, now Steve Marcus is taking the lead on this one. Mm-hmm. type notes. Yeah, kind of flutter for a few bars like that, and then like stretch one note out for another few. Oh, really discombobulated, just kind of everyone going in different directions, like... It's almost like smoke is clearing from a scene where something just, like, fell to earth. Okay, I'm wondering how this pertains to Scotland. Like, what kind of visuals is this supposed to conjure up in Scotland? Like... Okay, this is based around the earworm of that ascending bass riff right there, and then the wind down scaly bits that answer it. I love the contrast between that 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2, and that really tense up and up, and then the way they just let it all go, like. Yeah, so that basically part is the rhythm section, and then the other part is like Steve Marcus. It's almost like they're trying to like work their way out of the confetti that Marcus keeps throwing around. Okay, and this was written by Larry Coryell. Between the two of them, I just can't tell you who's the ultimate player. Yeah, they're both so like equal in terms of their fluidity and their piercing like distinct tone and just that. Now he's being a little bit more persistent. He's not letting that ascending riff kind of take over each time he, you know, runs back around it. He's playing over it. Yeah, whereas before they were trading off, and now he's just kind of like mangling them. Coryell's trying to like fight his way through this now. He's kind of low in the mix, but if you really listen, you can hear him just with that fuzzy searing tone, just kind of playing these sustained notes and then throwing some chords around, trying to like work his way. I think he's gonna maybe kind of overtake them. Thank you. I love the, how they throw in the they start to like hammer in on certain notes as things just swell up and get louder. And... wonder if some of these soloists, like particularly Marcus here, is like with each go around was like thinking to himself, what kind of technique or method have I not employed yet, and just trying to make each run as different as possible from the preceding one. I guess neither of these tracks feature much presence of keyboardist Mike Mandel, who's credited with electric piano with Fuzz-wah. I haven't really been hearing much of that. I almost thought I was about to on the last track. Tracks that just takes a repetition out to its utmost of swelling intensity. Yeah. I've heard this kind of composition on a few of these albums. I think there's one track. At least on John McLaughlin's Devotion album that has kind of his psychedelic rock album that has kind of a similar like repetition. I think it's built like on ascent or a descent or something that just keeps swelling and getting thicker. And you know, there's a track on one of the Isotope albums too that this kind of presages, yeah, from their second album. Illusion. And now we're coming undone again. It looks like we're gonna conclude like we started, kind of just all. Everything, just all the pieces scattered about. Hear those harmonic notes? Like, dum, boom, boom, pull-offs. Think of like glowing like lights, kind of like kaleidoscopic, like Super 8 footage, that grainy film, the 70s. Yes, one of those sequences where they focus it on lights and like some in the background kind of blurry, some in the foreground kind of grainy. That was Larry Coryell with Scotland Eye from his 1972 release Offering, and before that, the title track. Recorded January 17th, 18th, and 20th at Vanguard Studios in New York. Yeah, Larry Coryell, one of the guitarists who would just dominate the 70s jazz rock scene. Yeah, really quite up there, and done a whole bunch of things. Going back to the late 60s, he played in the Free Spirits, one of the first bands to combine jazz and rock. Back in 1967, I mean, predating the brass rock bands, predating everything, yeah. Around this time was, in addition to being very prolific as a solo artist, did several collaborative efforts and even appeared in the German jazz rock supergroup, etc., led by Wolfgang Dauner, and then, of course, would form the 11th House, jazz rock powerhouse, for record three albums, and then continued to record through the later part of the decade, did some collaborative work with people like Steve Kahn, Philip Catherine, and in the early 1980s appeared in another supergroup, Fuse One. Yeah, just very active over a five-decade career. Yeah, yeah. Anyway, for more Rubies and Sapphires from this Larry Coryell album anyway, see the directory of albums from 1972, linked in the description below, for Red Hot Tracks and Purples, from more than 1,040 albums from that jam-packed year with great music from across the musical spectrum. Like and subscribe, follow me on social media, share the video, and leave a comment if there are any observations you have about the two tracks we just heard. The interplay, the soloing, the scaling, the dazzling, the, you know, harmelotics and sizzling, fiery tone of each of the main soloists and the intensity of the various passages. Yeah, who had the best moment, the best break, the best, you know, bits. And until next time, this is Zaragon, the world's most ear-traveled trimaximalist, signing off.